Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee in 2022. I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is evidence taking on the draft of the fourth National Planning Framework, or NPF4. This morning, we will be hearing from the Scottish Government officials. This is the first of five evidence sessions the committee will be holding on NPF4. I would like to welcome to the committee Fiona Simpson, Chief Planner, and Andy Kinnard, Head of Transforming Planning at the Scottish Government. Thank you for joining us today. And we're going to move straight to questions, and I'm going to begin by asking if you could, and I think I'll direct this initially to Fiona, if you could briefly outline how the Scottish Government engaged with communities and planning stakeholders in the development of the draft NPF4.
Thank you, Convener. So National Planning Framework 4 has been built from early engagement and collaboration from the start of the process. And this has really shaped the priorities and the structure and the content of the document as a whole. The process has been about much more than just consulting people on a draft after it's been prepared. We've taken an approach to co-production, really, from the early stages of the process. Firstly, we ran an open call for ideas in early 2020. And this was followed by a fuller consultation on a position statement that we published later on in that year. And now we have a current consultation running on the draft National Planning Framework 4. I think it's important to say that throughout we've targeted different audiences, whether that's the professional sector or key sectors with an interest in particular policies or areas of the document, a wide range of organisations and communities. And we've worked really hard ensuring communities can get involved as part of that, as well as working closely with planning authorities. We've used a variety of methods to do this, whether that's easy read materials and guides, events, using different techniques to involve people, drop-in events that people can just turn up and have a discussion with us. We've worked through and with networks. And we've done online, obviously, as well as in-person engagement. If it's okay, I would like to invite Andy Kinnair to add some further detail to that.
Yes, please.
Okay, thank you, Convener, and good morning. I can just run through a bit of the detail. So our initial call for ideas ran from January to April 2020. That was a period of 16 weeks, which included an extension of 4 weeks due to the first lockdown. We received around 350 responses to the call for ideas, and supporting that consultation, our engagement programme had included an early session with the Scottish Youth Parliament, then onto a roadshow where we met with over 180 workshop participants plus 100 or so who attended the drop-in discussions. The roadshow attended 13 locations around Scotland, and we also had sessions at two schools, at Bucky High and at Bedalbin Academy. Unfortunately, the last seven events from our roadshow had to be cancelled due to the start of the lockdown, but at that point we published a blog showing how people could get involved in other ways, and it was at that point we extended that deadline by 4 weeks. Produced a resource pack to help people be able to engage with us. That pack had maps and presentations and leaflets, a guide to holding community workshops themselves, some policy background notes, information on submitting national development suggestions, a guide to impact assessments, and a housing technical paper. At that point, we also provided a community grant scheme offering small grants to support local engagement and events. Later in that year, in November 2020, we published the Scottish Government's position statement, setting out the direction of travel in our emerging thinking and drawing on what people had told us in response to the call for ideas. We hadn't previously intended to do that, but delays from the pandemic presented us with an opportunity to test our thinking. So We ran a further consultation on that position statement over a 12-week period, and we received around 250 responses to that, about 20% of those from individuals and the rest from organisations, including community councils, residents associations and campaign groups. And again, supporting that consultation, with some events, we commissioned PAS, Planning Aid Scotland, to host a series of 5 community discussion events and also some youth engagement involving a survey and virtual workshops at which 200 young people participated. We also commissioned the RTPI to hold 4 cross-sector roundtables under headings of post-COVID recovery, 20-minute neighbourhoods, achieving net zero and delivering good quality development. If I may just sort of mention, sort of going forward, sort of building on those experiences, we're backing up our current consultation on the draft NPF4, and that's involving some open invitation facilitated events, 9 in total, covering the 4 policy themes and the 5 action areas in the draft NPF. And we, again, have produced some online resources, including presentations, policy background notes, digital narratives, and all of the evidence that we received through the call for ideas and a position statement. We're just sort of putting the finishing touches now and are about to launch these open invitation events. We've again launched a community grant scheme to support community groups to help them to engage with us through the consultation. And we're exploring with potential facilitators how best to further discuss with community groups. And we've just had confirmation that our bid for a workshop at the next Scottish Youth Parliament gathering in March has been successful, and we're meeting this afternoon with Play Scotland to discuss further opportunities for engaging with young people. I think I'll stop at that. That's okay.
Thank you very much for that, from both of you. Certainly very thorough work that you've been doing, and during this challenging time of the pandemic, clearly restricting activity. So I'm aware that, you know, obviously the consultation is still running, but we've had, you know, several stakeholders who've questioned the Scottish Government running a consultation on the draft NPF4 during the 120-day period for parliamentary scrutiny, and you can imagine that, you know, that does cause challenges. So could you please explain to the committee the Scottish Government's interpretation of the Planning Scotland Act 2019 in that regard? And I don't know which one of you wants to pick that up, but yep, great, Andy, thanks.
Okay, thank you, convener. I'll just sort of pick that one up for us. We had been sort of looking at the new statutory procedure for the NPF that was set by the 2019 Scotland Act, and in particular, there's the Section 3C8, subsection 3, groups together the requirement for ministers to consult in accordance with the participation statement, and also lay before the Scottish Parliament the draft that we're currently looking at just now, but then to have regard to all representations received on those within the no more than 120-day period. So I do appreciate that there can be a bit of awkwardness around running the two at the same time, but we feel that's the way we needed to do it to make sure that our requirement to take into account all of the representations within that 120-day period meant that both ran at the same time.
Okay, thanks for that response. I'd now like to move on to a question from Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Kevina. Good morning. I just wanted to ask about competing priorities for planners and local councillors who will make decisions. You know, NPF4 will be part of a redevelopment plan, and sometimes planners and councillors will be expected to balance competing policy objectives within different documents within that plan, but also perhaps competing priorities with their local communities who may or may not be so supportive of what's in the plan. Are you able to set out what guidance the Directorate are going to give to planning authorities and councillors as to how they balance those competing priorities? Andy.
Yeah, thank you. I suppose the first thing to say is that planning is all about balancing competing objectives and priorities. It's in the nature of what we do. Every development proposal is unique. You know, the proposal itself, its location, how it relates to its broader context. So Under planning legislation, decisions on individual planning applications must be made in accordance with the development plan, but also taking into account all relevant material considerations. So the policies need to be read in the round and weighed up together in decisions. So it would be for the decision maker themselves to take into account all those relevant policies, including those set out in NPF4, and therefore those that are in the development plan. In drafting the NPF, we sought to balance providing clarity and certainty with the need for that flexibility for decision makers to be able to account for local circumstances. So it's very much in the nature of what we do. There will be competing priorities, competing policies. Things don't always pull in entirely the same direction, but that's what planning has to do, and sort of just take account of each of them and attach the appropriate weight.
Okay, so you feel that NPF4 and the associated documents lean more towards flexibility for local decision making rather than taking a stricter approach?
Yeah, I wouldn't say it's about the NPF leaning to flexibility. That flexibility is inbuilt in the planning system itself. So we want to ensure the plan-led system operates well. The NPF, as part of the development plan, will do that. We want to make sure that our policies are as clear and as direct as possible. But the planning system is written in a way that allows for that bit of flexibility to consider all relevant considerations.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Mark. I'm going to come in with another question, and I think, well, again, put an R in the chat, Fiona or Andy, who wants to come in on this. Can you set out how the national developments included NPF4 were chosen and how these will align with other Scottish Government policy documents? For example, none of the national developments appear to feature in the infrastructure investment plan. So I think I saw Fiona and then Andy, so I'll go with Fiona.
Okay, thank you, Convener. I'll start off. Andy may add further. So just to talk you through the process of how we selected the national developments, it's important to note we issued a call for national developments as part of the initial call for ideas. But ideas also came from the regional spatial strategies, the indicative regional spatial strategies that local authorities were looking at, as well as responses to the position statement. We received about 259 suggestions for national developments, and most of those have informed the draft NPF. Some have been adopted as proposed national developments in the draft, and others are part of the spatial strategy. The suggestions we received, we looked at either individually or as groups where there were similar proposals. And we considered them in relation to four criteria: climate change, people, inclusive growth, and place. And those are criteria that are actually shared across a whole range of wider Scottish Government policies and programmes. So that helped to achieve the alignment that you mentioned. We also did a full integrated impact assessment, and that was an iterative process. So we took into account the impacts of the developments as we progressed the assessment. Some of the proposals were really good ideas, but perhaps weren't actual development proposals. And some were broad ideas that were already advanced, for example, already had development consent in place. So we had to look at how the proposals related to the planning system. And we considered all of this in relation to the emerging spatial strategy and the collaborative work that we did with local authorities to develop that spatial strategy. And as the spatial strategy began to take shape, we asked ourselves which of these national developments can best support delivery of that spatial strategy. So the proposed national developments in the draft are those that we think will help to deliver the spatial strategy to a degree that makes them of more than local or regional significance. And we've published a full report of the assessment of national developments on the Scottish Government website, and we're obviously seeking views on that now. In terms of integration with wider policies, as I say, that those priorities that shaped the call for national developments and our analysis are shared across a wide range of key policies and strategies, and so that alignment should take place in that way.
Thank you. Andy, do you want to come in on anything else? Or
No, it's fine, convener. I think we were both very keen to jump in there, but Fiona's got it covered. Thanks.
Great. Good. Thanks very much. So we're going to move on to another question, and this time from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to you, Fiona and Andy. I wanted to just ask a broader question, if I may. We know that NPF4 places the current Scottish plan and policy document, and future frameworks will become a formal part of every local development plan. Firstly, maybe Fiona, could you just set out for us, give us a flavour of what the more significant changes are that we're hoping to bring in with this framework? And secondly, are the local authorities themselves okay with it? Do they see it as an imposition on local flexibility and that sort of issue, please? So I'd be obliged for a response to that. Thank you.
Okay, there's quite a lot of change that we're introducing in the NPF, but I'll try to just walk you through some of the big changes. You know, overall, the document is really trying to focus on the key themes that I've already outlined, and in particular, we really looked at every policy and part of the strategy to see how it could best contribute to net zero, as well as the nature crisis. So that cut across everything, but also within the context of recovery from the pandemic as well. So there's a whole load of key drivers that drove quite significant change. We took into account the fact that NPF will have a different status as part of the statutory development plan now, and that's quite a change from NPF3. We took into account wider policies and priorities and thought about what has changed. We thought about what the new requirements are that stem from the Planning Scotland Act 2019. Obviously, we've done a lot of early engagement, so consultee views also shaped what the priorities were. And crucially, thinking about how to have a spatial strategy that could be delivered through sound policies. So the policies bring forward what was in the Scottish Planning Policy, but a lot of them have been significantly changed or updated, and there's quite a few new ones. So I can run through in a wee bit more detail some of the big changes. Policies 1 to 6, the universal policies that we set out, are largely new, and we've covered some key principles here around the importance of a plan-led system, the climate emergency, the nature crisis, human rights, equality and discrimination, one of the statutory outcomes for NPF to address, community wealth building, a key theme that we want to see cutting across decisions, and we've updated our policy on good quality design. Policies 6 to 14, some of the newer policies here are around 20-minute neighbourhoods, an infrastructure-first approach, play and health. And again, that flows from much of the debate during the planning bill, but also some of the statutory requirements and our emphasis on that sort of local livability that we think is really important for net zero in the future. Policies 16 to 23 look at productive places. Again, we took into account the changing context for work as part of this. For example, policy 16 covers things like home working and live work units. We've got new policies on sustainable tourism and culture and creativity. And we've introduced significant changes in the draft to policy 19 on green energy and on zero waste, because we think they have a really critical role to play as part of the drive to net zero. And the final section is around policies 24 to 35 on distinctive places. Again, a fair amount of change here. So there's quite significant changes to policies relating to city and town and local centres, and that aims to respond to the town centre review. We've got a new policy on vacant and derelict land. We think that's really important to support sustainable patterns of development. Policy 31 on rural development has changed quite significantly again. We heard during the planning bill, the debate on the planning bill, there was a lot of emphasis on growing the population of rural Scotland. We've updated our other policies in this section, including on peat, carbon-rich soils, woodlands and trees and coasts, again, to reflect climate change. So there's a whole range of drivers. We've taken into account what has changed since MPF 3 was published and what the Scottish Planning Policies said in 2014. In terms of local authorities, we've worked closely with local authorities in a number of ways throughout the process. Whether that's through the work that we've done with them on collaborative work at a regional scale, form the spatial strategy. Local authorities contributed to obviously the call for ideas, and there was a lot of consultation responses from them. I think 29 responded to the consultation on the position statement. They've worked closely with us on the housing land requirements and contributed to many of the policies. They were part of stakeholder groups, for example, on our work on the nature policy. They've helped us with research, and they've been engaged in different areas of the document. So much of that work has flowed through from our work on planning reform, which again has been really close working with local authorities.
Mm-hmm. That is really thorough, Fiona. Thank you. And I'm sure colleagues in the committee will pick out some of those items as we go along. But could I just, for my second question, just pick out one of them? I'd previously raised the issue of derelict abandoned shops, building and land, and you mentioned it near the end of your statement there. Do you think it gives local authorities any more powers to deal with these issues? When I look at the breadth of MPF4, it looks great. There's a lot of good things in there. But what I see as a local member, and I saw as a local councillor for many years, is derelict and abandoned shops, buildings and pieces of land, and really limited powers that the local authorities had to try to affect change and to serve amenity notices and so on to improve the environment, particularly within our towns. So do you see the framework giving us any strengthened additional powers in relation to that, so that it can make some kind of contribution to the overall look and feel that a town or towns and villages might need to have to support them going forward?
Well, I would say that the framework is about policy rather than powers, but we have tried to be very clear in our policy about the importance of this and the importance of good quality placemaking and how we can channel new development that obviously the planning system deals with to improve our places. We've touched on delivery in the final section. That is still a work in progress because it's, you know, we're conscious that this is a draft document and more work will be needed on delivery. But we've touched on the importance of thinking about how MPF will be delivered and thinking about the tools and mechanisms that could be there to support that. But that sort of fits within a wider picture of planning reform where we're looking at moving local development plans, for example, to a 10-year review cycle in the same way that National Planning Framework has. And the aim of that is to spend a bit less time on preparing plans and more time then on implementing the plans, and that should free up a bit of resource in the planning system to do that. So a work in progress around delivery, but I think the policy intent around vacant and derelict land and quality of place is very clear in the draft document.
Okay, thank you. I can follow up on that. Thanks very much for that, Fiona. Probably back to you, convener, to allow other members to come in. Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. And I'd like to now bring Miles Briggs in.
Thank you, convener. Good morning to yourself, Fiona and Andy. Thanks for joining us this morning. I wanted to follow on from the line of questioning Willie just took forward with regards to renewable energy. Looking at the draft MPF4, I think there are a number of questions with regards to the signal it sends around the presumption in favour or not in favour of renewable energy development. So I wanted to ask, how was that designed And is that your expectation when we're trying to meet these climate change targets, that there will be a presumption in favour of renewable energy developments across Scotland?
Thanks. So we have taken a different approach and used different language to presumption in favour. So each of the policies set out what should and should not be supported, and we've tried to make that as clear as possible throughout the document. Work on renewable energy, we have the policy intent we've been very clear about from the start, which is to enable all sorts of technologies and renewable energy development as part of that, to recognise its importance as a contribution to the net zero agenda. So we looked at the existing policy and looked at what could be changed about it. Obviously, we took into account a wide range of views from the consultation about how the policy could evolve, and we considered a wider, obviously, government policy and strategy to make sure that planning was aligned with that. We've updated the policy on renewable energy, and it sets out that there's support for renewable energy development other than, and it, with regard to wind farms, other than in national parks and national scenic areas. And from that, we're expecting each proposed development to be assessed on a case-by-case basis. We've set out what the considerations are around that, and we've tried to really emphasise throughout the spatial strategy as a whole the importance of renewable energy, not just in relation to net zero, but in terms of shaping the future of places and the opportunities that provides for large parts of Scotland to achieve real benefits. I would also mention the new policy on climate that we set out, policy two. So that's giving significant weight to the global climate emergency as part of the process. And again, that's really trying to underline the importance of these technologies.
Thank you for that. The section specifically, though, on renewable energy seems to lack clarity, and that sometimes looks to contradict itself as well. And I think that's where there's a concern around different priorities being open to interpretation. Now, obviously, we as a committee can't amend the draft plan, but in terms of the consultation you're having with energy developers, where is that discussion taken forward? Because we know there's been a number of complaints previously that renewable energy developments have not been taken forward, or the time it's taken within councils to get those taken forward, or in fact being called in by the government when they're rejected. So I just wondered what learning has taken place and what future development to make sure that that renewable energy comes on as quickly as possible into our energy needs.
I think this is the benefit of now being at the stage where we have a draft policy set out in the National Planning Framework, and that's the purpose of this consultation. So we have obviously engaged with all sectors, including the renewable energy sector, throughout the process. We've taken into account views that we've had, including on the consultation on the position statement, where there is support. But this is the draft is the first time where we've set out in detail the policy wording, and that's really the stage where we're very keen to hear views from all stakeholders on how the policy looks, how it could work in practice, and whether they feel we've got the wording right to reflect the policy intent. So I think that's really the purpose of this consultation now, and we'll be meeting with renewable energy sector representatives, no doubt, during the consultation process to discuss that further, as well as taking into account a whole range of views from all stakeholders.
That's helpful, thank you. And I wanted to move on to the recently introduced planning legislation requiring Scottish ministers to set out how NPF will contribute towards meeting a series of outcomes, including around the needs of people living, particularly housing needs of older people and disabled people. So I wondered, there has been criticism, for example, from the Law Society, who questioned whether or not the approach is compliant with the Planning Act. So I just wondered if you could explain to us your approach with regards to that, and how those outcomes will actually be included in NPF4. I don't know if Fiona or Andy.
I think Andy's.
Yep. Okay, thank you. Yes, I'll answer that one. So yes, the Planning Act places this new requirement that the NPF must contain a statement about how development will contribute to these six statutory outcomes. We included a first cut of that statement at Annex A of the draft NPF 4 in the interest of transparency. And I appreciate that's the point that the Law Society was referring to. But that sort of first cut cross-refers to some of the policies contained within the draft that we think demonstrate how they will contribute to the outcomes. But we've also included a specific consultation question just to explore this new requirement and the draft text we've offered further to make sure that it's sufficiently robust to meet the requirements. So we will revisit that with the benefit of the responses we receive when we formally produce the statement that we're required to accompany the final version of NPF 4, however it may have been revised by that time.
That's really helpful. Yeah, thanks very much. I'm grateful for that clarity. And just finally, I wanted to ask, it relates, I suppose, to my initial questions with regards to the new requirement on developers and planning authorities to life cycle carbon emissions of certain developments and for these to be assessed by developers. And I just wondered, in terms of taking that policy forward and planning officers being tasked with doing that, what impact assessment has actually been undertaken to look at that new requirement? And has that been conducted, or is that something which during the course of this consultation will be looked at? Because it could be very significant and potentially burdensome process for developers and individual councils as well.
I'll start to answer that, but Fiona may want to come in and join in. So the assessment of sort of life cycle is something that we've considered in relation to all of the national developments which we're required to do. So the proposed national developments have had that assessment carried out. We appointed consultants to do that for us. There is also the requirement within the new Planning Act, though, that for all major developments in the future, they would also have that assessment carried out. So we're going to build on the experiences we've had through the NPF to then sort of produce the guidance for how that would be taken forward for assessments on all major developments in the future. I don't know if Fiona might want to add a little bit to that.
Yeah, just to add to that, so we recognise that this is quite a challenge. As Andy said, we have drawn on work that was commissioned and undertaken by Climate Exchange to look at the methodologies that can be used in this. It is something that we want to see applied, and in the policy we've tried to take a proportionate approach where there's a higher level of assessment for developments like national developments and major developments, or EIA developments, where a fuller environmental impact assessment would be undertaken in any case. So we've tried to take a proportionate approach. We recognise there's possibly a need for guidance on this, and we'll look at that in the round, thinking about where the priorities for guidance are. But I would say, given the climate emergency, it's really important that planners are skilled and have the knowledge to be able to understand what the emissions arising from developments will be in the future, to be able to make sure that the decisions they make will contribute to reducing emissions in the long term.
Thank you for that. Just before I hand back to you, Convener, I just wanted to look at this, because I think it's an important issue and it's something we should seriously consider at this stage, because I think for a lot of developments, potential life cycle carbon emissions, we've got to look at that potentially how technology, how other schemes could reduce them before, after they've been built, for example, community heat schemes. I know a number of these taking place in Edinburgh. These developments are already underway, but there's the potential in the future. So I just wanted to put on record that point, that there seems to be a lot of cart before the horse potentially now taking place in developments where they could actually have a lower carbon footprint, but they might not go ahead if they're not if that's not taken into account during the life cycle of carbon emissions. So I don't know if you want to come back on that, but it's something I think we should be aware of as well, that this could potentially prevent development as well.
Okay, I don't see anyone indicating. Yeah, thanks, Miles. Okay, so I just want to bring in Paul, who wanted to come in and pick up a bit more on the renewables theme. Paul McClellan.
Thanks, convener. And it's probably just coming back to the point, as you said, about that Miles Briggs was raising. It's about the, obviously, about the renewables and deliverability of renewables. Obviously, we had the ScotWind announcement yesterday, which is great news and substantial, obviously, planning requirements will come out of that. And I wanted to ask probably Fiona, first of all, Fiona, obviously part of the MPF4 is around about its deliverability, and obviously ScotWind is presenting major opportunities as well as the existing renewables applications that are going through. I'm just wondering what consideration has been given to, for example, around about resource planning in that regard, because MPF4 is all about deliverability. Do we have the resource at the moment to deliver on the renewables, and obviously in the future in terms of delivering ScotWind as well, the proposals around about ScotWind, to ensure that we do have, as I said, enough resource to deliver what's been proposed.
Thanks. So, yes, so ScotWind and actually the wider longer-term future around renewable energy features right across the spatial strategy, where we've emphasised the importance of the blue economy. We've highlighted opportunities to fit with a growing rural population and the future for the islands as part of the low carbon agenda. All of that plays out across the spatial strategy. In terms of the resource, I think that's a very good question. It's really important that the planning system is able to respond to the opportunities that we have here. We do have, we're conscious of the issues around resourcing for planning authorities, and we do work through the high-level group with COSLA and SOLAS and Heads of Planning Scotland and the Royal Town Planning Institute to look at resourcing of planning authorities. I think this will be a really exciting opportunity for planning to really show how a strong planning system that actively enables development and supports the smooth transition of applications through the system can contribute to the wider economy of Scotland and the benefits that flow from that. And planning can add a lot of value by thinking about what that means for our future places and how that those benefits can be secured locally. So I don't have the answer in terms of resourcing, but I am conscious that it is an important part of the strategy. We will be looking at delivery in more detail. We've asked the Scottish Futures Trust to take forward some work throughout the consultation period on the draft national planning framework to explore delivery in more detail. And some of that will focus on the national developments, but also some of the wider priorities that are arising from the different action areas as well. So that's a work in progress, I would say, and at this stage the important thing for us was to set out what we thought that the draft should be and the detailed wording for a fuller consultation, but we are following that up with fuller consideration of delivery.
No, thank you, Fiona. I think that's really helpful, because obviously I'll probably pick that up at a later stage, in future discussions. No doubt, we'll be discussing MPF4 on a regular basis in the next few months. But that's good to know, and I'll probably raise that, further down the line once that consultation has been had. Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Thank you. Thank you, Paul. I'm actually going to just pick up on a couple of things. So one, Fiona, you were saying earlier that, one of the focuses of MPF is about growing the rural population. And one of the things that I'm aware of being Highlands and Islands MSP is the tension between, and you spoke also about renewable energy potentially, being something that can support rural population because it will bring jobs. But there, what I'm picking up is a tension between, some speaking more about onshore wind rather than our offshore wind. Places that happen to have a lot of wind seem to get a lot of planning applications, obviously, for renewable energy. And what I'm hearing from people is that tension, because they also have or are growing a tourism sector. And so there's a kind of this tension between inviting people to a really beautiful Scottish landscape and to enjoy their time there and their visit in Scotland, with the tension of the need for the energy and the kind of planning applications. So just something about that. Where's the help for thinking well about, you know, do we concentrate renewable onshore wind in places, or is there consideration around that?
I think so. I think it's important to remember this is a framework. So what we've tried to do in the National Planning Framework draft is to recognise that rural places are very diverse, and that there's different pressures and challenges in different parts of rural Scotland. And that was all informed by research that we commissioned on rural planning, and that's really helped us develop our policies. We're trying to take a balanced approach, and there will be competing pressures. And one of the things we try to do within the spatial strategy is to set out a framework for emphasising that rural areas, you know, low carbon development in rural areas will look different in different parts of the country, and to provide a framework within which local development plans will play a crucial role in thinking in more detail about the balance of uses and a strategy for those different areas. And I would go further than that and say, a really important part of planning reform has been the introduction of local place plans, and we would want to see local place plans also bringing together communities to set out what their aspirations are for their area, and for that to feed into local development planning from a community level. So we've sought to achieve that balance. We've been very clear that the drive to address net zero is an overarching priority. But we thought about how that can create opportunities for sustainable development of rural communities, and try to create positive synergies rather than just sort of ignoring the conflicts there, try to bring them together in a positive way. Hope that answers your question.
Thanks, that's very helpful. I just want to pick up on the piece about local place plans, because I think within the committee ourselves, but also talking to stakeholders, we do have some concern about, and I know that we just a statutory instrument just came through our committee, but you know, how will local place plans really be respected and honoured if we have a local development plan that is 10 years? Where, how do you imagine if a community, you know, 3 or 4 years into that development plan, then kind of like realises they want some agency, they want some input into how things are being shaped or how the response to climate and nature is taking place? How will that then be respected and really given the power to have that there for the communities to have their say?
I think Andy Kinnaird was going to come in here.
Thanks, yep. Andy.
I can pick this up. So this was actually one of the specific points that was debated during the planning bill during the last parliament, was that how can we make sure a local place plan coming on sort of mid-term of a local development plan can still have some influence. And there are kind of, I suppose, two parts to the answer to this. First of all is that local place plan would already become a material consideration in the planning system. So again, would be for the decision maker to consider just what weight to attach to that. But the Act also allows for us to bring forward regulations covering the arrangements for an interim amendment of the local development plan as well. So it would be possible for the planning authority, rather than reviewing the entire LDP, to just amend parts of it that would allow them to bring the elements of the local place plan that they support on board into the formal development plan.
Okay, thank you for that. And then just another one, which is, you know, the MPF4 plan-led approach. There's a lot of focus on planning departments, and it's quite concerning because we've been taking evidence from, you know, planning stakeholders about the, you know, lack of resources. And so I just wonder if you think that there are the resources required in planning departments to cope with things like life cycle emissions assessments. You know, they're already stretched, and then we're going to be asking them to do more things. So it's like, you know, what do we need in place to ensure that we've got the, you know, they've got the proper funding, we've got enough planners, that's the other thing we've been hearing about, and then even people, you know, specialists like ecologists to be looking at aspects that really need to be considered.
Yeah, so we are very much aware that planning departments have seen reductions in their budgets and ultimately reductions in staff numbers over time. While the overall resourcing of authorities is provided through the local government budget settlement, however, planning fees do have a very important role in ensuring that applicants rather than the taxpayer covers the cost of determining any applications. You'll probably be aware we conducted a consultation seeking views on updating the planning performance and fee regimes back in December 19, 2019 through to February 2020. Implementation of that new fee regime we had to postpone during the pandemic. However, we can recommence that work last summer with a view to laying new fee regulations, which we'll do in the next few weeks, which we intend to come into effect this coming April. Those will see fees increasing in some of the cases by between 25% and 50%, so looking to get substantial more resource into planning authorities. Once we've increased those fees, we'll be looking to monitor their impact and use that to inform our future work programme in relation to planning resources and performance. And that continues to be a key priority that we have in working with the High Level Group on Planning Performance. You mentioned the point, convener, about making sure we're getting people into the profession. So we're also supporting HOPS and the RTPI at the moment in their current work to encourage more people into the planning profession. Recognise that getting more funding in is only part of the story. The planners need to be out there. So yeah, we have kind of been picking up this work with HOPS and the RTPI, and also again working closely with the High Level Group and with the Partners in Planning Group as well. That's another sort of vital element, that getting more money in is one part, but making sure we get planners into the system as well is equally vital.
Thanks very much, Andy. I'm going to bring Miles in for a supplementary on.
Thank you, convener. It's just following on from your line of questioning. I wanted to ask, and it's an issue I think every single MSP and MP and councillor, to be quite frank, are always concerned around, and that is community building, where we see large-scale housing developments. Now, I've faced this over the last 5 years with a significant house building which is going on across Lothian, and the lack of forward planning with regards to health services, local primary schools, for example, and community facilities, because I think that is genuinely how we build community. So I just wondered how this latest fourth edition of the National Planning Framework would help change that going forward. Not sure who wants to answer that specifically.
I think Fiona's coming in this one.
Good. Thanks, Fiona.
So this has been a key theme throughout planning reform since the work we did way back in 2015 around infrastructure and planning and the importance of linking up house building with wider community facilities and services has been a really important theme. We have sought to address that within this draft, and there's a number of ways that we've done that. There's a new policy, for example, on 20-minute neighbourhoods. So thinking about things in the round is really what the concept of 20-minute neighbourhoods is all about. There's a new policy on taking an infrastructure-first approach to development planning and to thinking about the impacts of development proposals on infrastructure. It's a really important message within that overall policy. And we've also looked at the policies on housing. The Scottish Planning Policy set out quite a long and complicated way of calculating housing numbers because we're taking a different approach here in response to the statutory requirement. We're setting out what the minimum all-tenure housing land requirement would be for local authorities to work from. We think that by doing that, that there can be a focus more on quality and placemaking when you're planning and delivering housing. So the emphasis there is on thinking about housing as part of a wider place-based strategy and actively planning that. And alongside this, we're currently consulting on draft regulations and guidance relating to local development plans. And again, that plays out as the key policy messages in the National Planning Framework through to draft guidance, which provides much more information on how we would expect local authorities to go about preparing local development plans, what sort of information we would want to see in an evidence report, and how they can then take that information and work through a spatial strategy and allocations of land in local development plans. I would also draw attention to one of the new policies under housing, which relates to the community benefit arising from housing proposals. And we've added that in response to a wide range of views. There's always quite a wide range of views on housing proposals. And we often hear from communities that they want to see if housing is taking place in their area, they want to see how that's going to impact on infrastructure and what the benefits would be. But we also hear from the house building sector, we heard from them during the consultation that people perhaps don't appreciate the benefits that are provided by new housing development. So that policy aims to draw that out and provide a clear, explicit statement for some applications that sets out what the benefits will be for the local area.
That's helpful, thank you. And one of the key parts of that jigsaw is actually often the health board and the delivery of health services. And GPs are private contractors to the health service, but in terms of any expansion in housing, they often don't see that additional funding coming from the health board to provide those additional services. So what change do you think is needed around that? So the National Planning Framework actually then also impacts on health boards in terms of additional funding or the reprovision of services to a greater number of people who, especially with new build developments, will be needing, often young families will be in there and needing a lot of additional health services.
I think the approach through planning is to really understand where there is existing capacity for starters when planning future development and allocating housing, and then understanding what the additional requirements are on top of that. It's an example of there is complexity around infrastructure planning because obviously infrastructure is provided not just by the public sector but by private sector. And there's a complex relationship between developer contributions that can be sought from proposals for development. So we're trying to address that by encouraging authorities to work with others in preparing local development plans. So it's not a lot of the purpose of what we're trying to achieve from the planning system is not to expect authorities to plan and take forward delivery on their own, but to work in a way that is collaborative with a wide range of infrastructure providers to understand what the capacity is, what else is required, and how best to plan the delivery of that. So in short, it's a complicated process, but we have sought to address that through the Infrastructure First policy. We've backed that up with the draft guidance on local development planning, and we'll continue to work on that as we explore the delivery programme for the NPF as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Miles. I'm now going to move on to questions from Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Before I ask my questions this morning, I'd just like to refer members to interests, as I am a serving councillor in North Lanarkshire. And my question relates to a topic that we've touched on slightly already, and it's in relation to 20-minute neighbourhoods. And my question is, several respondents to the committee's call for views have raised concerns that the definitions and delivery mechanisms for 20-minute neighbourhoods and community wealth building are not sufficiently clear. A concern for decision makers given the quasi-judicial nature of planning and the planning process. So I'd just like to ask the panel, how will these concerns be addressed, and do they believe that there could be perhaps a conflict between the intention of bringing in these 20-minute neighbourhoods, but also the role and responsibilities of our councillors?
I think Andy Kinnaird is coming in here.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, maybe just kind of pick up that point around the definitions. We have included a glossary in the draft NPF, but we're sort of conscious that people are raising questions about the definitions in there themselves, or are asking for more references to be defined. So NPF 4 is going to be a statutory document, be approved by this Parliament and adopted by ministers. So in that, the text needs to be fixed within the NPF. It can't constantly evolve. So we need to be careful about over-defining references. But we can consider that further when we see what people are suggesting in terms of what they think the definitions should be, or where we need to be adding more definitions. We can kind of see what comes through people's responses. One of the other options could be that we include some working definitions and guidance outside of the NPF, so that allows the definitions that are maybe sort of a bit of a moving feast at the moment to be able to evolve. So we have sort of a few options around that, but we're being a bit wary about having sort of too many really tight definitions, particularly of things that are still evolving.
Thank you. Could I just pick up on that point just very briefly, Andy, please, in relation to over-defining? Could that therefore lead to, could that be open to interpretations between councils, and therefore you could have 32 councils doing 32 different things in relation to bringing in these 20-minute neighbourhoods?
I suspect to some extent you can get that anyway, even when you are quite tight in the definition, but yeah, we can certainly do all we can to help guide the understanding of what it is that we want the 20 neighbourhoods to be and to achieve, and that's something that's obviously moving forward at the moment anyway, and it's becoming better known.
Thank you.
Thanks, Megan, and I'm now going to bring in Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you, convener. And before I ask my question, I would just like to refer members to my register of interest. I'm still an existing councillor in East Ayrshire Council. Before I ask the question that I'm going to be asking, I would just like to revisit briefly community benefits, if I may. And I'm just wondering if NPF 4 and guidance that's going to come out is actually going to help local authorities to be able to zoom out, especially when there's multiple applications in for house building in a specific area, and how they actually can make sure that they actually have the cohesive best use of these developer contributions. And because sometimes you've got multiple applications for thousands of houses in a very small space from different applicants. And I'm just concerned that sometimes that doesn't actually always translate into the best use of those contributions. And I don't know if Andy or Fiona, who wants to come in on that? Thanks. Fiona, thanks.
So I'll start off, but we have actually been looking at developer contributions. We commissioned some research on this, and that's a kind of parallel piece of work that has been running alongside, obviously, the policy development. And I think it's really important that we get that right. We looked at this also when we introduced an infrastructure levy as part of the Planning Scotland's Act as well. As I mentioned before, it's complex and there's different ways of delivering development, but I think the really important message here is that we want local development plans to be supported firstly corporately across a council, so they're not just a document for planners, by planners, for planners, but they have that traction and support across a council, but also that they are a tool for engaging much more widely, whether that's setting out what the requirements are and the expectations are for the development sector, or they are inspiring others to get involved, or they're about a practical tool for bringing together all of the infrastructure requirements. So again, it's a complex picture, but I think the key lies in having a really strong place-based local development plan that is forms the basis of decisions about development and is signed up to by a wide range of parties. That can bring a strategic view of a place. It can be evidence-based, it can take into account the challenges and opportunities for that place, and it can set out a plan of action that's supported by a delivery programme. So, work in progress, but what we're thinking about in the MPF is how to provide a framework within which those plans can come forward.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Fiona, that's helpful. Policy 4 states that planning should respect, protect and fulfil human rights, seek to eliminate discrimination and promote equality. Now, these are outcomes that councillors, you know, and I know this as a councillor myself, you know, policies and plans seek to promote these. But could you explain what this means in practice for planning officers and for councillors who are on planning committees? Because it's maybe not something that's forefront in their mind when they're taking planning decisions, and in fact, you know, it's not something they've thought has been a material consideration. And just to pick up on the language a little bit, and when it says should, is that the same as must? If you could maybe speak a little bit to that. I'm not so sure who wants to pick up. I've got Andy in the chat. Andy, if you want to pick up on that, thanks.
Yes, certainly. So, yeah, improving equality and eliminating discrimination is one of those 6 high-level outcomes that's set in the Planning Act, which the NPF must contribute to. In planning, we can play quite a significant role through our choices and the decisions that we make to tackle inequality in our society and to lead the development of places that improve opportunities right across our communities. So that Policy 4, we recognise that planning needs to respect human rights, to seek to eliminate discrimination and promote equality, and to make sure we involve people meaningfully in making decisions about their places. Also ties in well with wider reforms such as the introduction of local place plans that will give people a better opportunity to get involved and to make sure the decision makers know and understand what they need and how they feel. Also, Policy 5 further develops that people-centred approach by support for community wealth building through planning decisions. So, progressing this and on publication of the draft NPF 4, we emailed around 70 equalities organisations to alert them to the consultation and asking them to publicise it across their networks. We're also holding an equalities roundtable discussion at the start of March, which we'll be able to explore this further. So we're looking forward to the feedback we get on these points to help us embed that focus on reducing disadvantage through the choices that are being made about places. And maybe just kind of pick up that point about the use of language and whether we should be saying must or should. We followed a convention across the draft that we'd only use the term must where that relates to a statutory requirement, and then sort of bring in should, where it's something that's much more a matter of policy or practice. And that shouldn't be kind of seen to read as should as a weakened message. It's still an expectation that should be done. We just have to be a bit more careful in the wording, especially if we were to say something that a proposed development must be supported or must not be supported in a particular circumstance, because the Planning Act requires that all decisions are made in accordance with the development plan and also considering all relevant material considerations. But we just have to be careful not to bring forward a policy that would push the position that a decision can swing or should swing just on one policy point without taking proper account of everything as required by the legislation. I hope that helps clarify that point.
Thanks very much for that, Andy. Just to pick up on a little point there, and before I hand back to the convener, in terms of perhaps training and skills development for those that are on planning committees and indeed the planners within those departments, you know, does this seek to actually put qualities on an even level playing field with, in terms of, you know, all the other material considerations, and should that be brought up further? You know, to the councillors on planning committees or planners themselves when they're actually taking a decision. So it's just to understand how is it actually going to work in practice for those that are taking those decisions. Thanks.
Yeah, I should probably just start by stressing there's no hierarchy within the policies that appear in the NPF. It's very much for the decision maker to consider everything that's relevant and to attach the weight that's appropriate. In terms of skills development, that's something that's across planning and including for councillors sitting on committees. Things have changed over time, and there are always a bit of new thinking that comes into the system, and that's something that we will sort of work with a higher level group on in terms of the skills for the planning services. There are also provisions that we've still to bring forward and commence from the 2019 Planning Act that will look at elected member training, so how we can set up what the priorities should be for that elected member training within planning. It was another one of those provisions that fell foul of the pandemic and the kind of change in our priorities that came along, but that's something that we are looking again to pick up on later this year, so that any new ideas, new thinking, new priorities that are coming into the planning system, including through NPF4, we'll be able to make sure there's a reasonable prospectus for member training going forward.
Great stuff. Thanks very much for that, Andy. Back to you, convener, for just now. Thanks.
Thanks, Helena. And that was good to hear, Andy, because I think really, you know, underlying a lot of what we have to do in response to climate, nature, emergencies, equalities is really a change in thinking, a change in mindset, and that really has to happen in the training. And you know, it's not just going to happen necessarily in people by themselves. So it's good to hear that that's being considered. I'd like to bring in Mark Griffin with a couple of questions.
Thanks, Kamina. I just wanted to ask about the deliverability, essentially, of a number of the proposals. Or there are a lot of very desirable proposals that committees will want to see delivered, and just to ask if there's been any thought to producing a document just setting out the Scottish Government's capital investment plan to support those proposals so that they can be scrutinised in the round and for committees get a better idea of what will and perhaps wouldn't be delivered.
Thank you. I can come in on this one. So I think delivery, and we've mentioned this a few times before, but our work is underway on a delivery programme. But obviously we're being very careful because we're conscious that this is a draft and it could well change. So pinning down a delivery programme at this stage is probably not the best thing to do, but really important throughout the consultation process to have a conversation about deliverability. Obviously, there's a wide range of partners involved, public and private sectors in delivery and communities as part of that. So we need to think about how things align rather than having a single dedicated capital investment programme. It's how planning is a tool for implementing those programmes, but also helps to shape those as they evolve. Obviously, it's complex, and we're conscious this is a draft, but the Scottish Futures Trust will be leading some collaborative work on delivery, and that will bring together stakeholders as part of our engagement programme to think about how we can have a shared delivery programme to take forward the National Planning Framework. And delivery programmes will have a really important role to play as part of the local development plan process. We'll be able to take into account things like the Infrastructure Investment Plan, the recommendations of the Infrastructure Commission for Scotland, but also the place principle has a really important role to play here, because as planning is about place, so the place principle is about how to get people working together to support delivery of change in a positive way and in a way that provides much more benefit because they're aligning and because they're working together to really focus on what is special about a place, what needs to change and how can we achieve more by working together. So the outcomes from all of this work that we're taking forward on delivery and will progress will be a delivery programme that will accompany the finalised draft of the NPF4 once it's approved and adopted. So we can take it so far at the National planning framework level, we would expect authorities to pick that up in their delivery programmes for their local development plans too. But the main point of all of this is to get people behind planning and to make sure planning influences how people work together in places.
Thanks for that. I take your point about delivery plans not being in place until a final document is approved. And so to go on to the more long-term nature of deliverability, this document will be in place for much longer than its predecessors, and now 10 years as opposed to 5. So then continuing on that theme of deliverability, how will that longer period of time impact on when any reviews might take place, how progress of implementation is tracked, how it might be amended, and if possible, given the longer timescales involved?
Okay, so we learned quite a lot from National Planning Framework 3, because for that we had a kind of online delivery programme that acted as a way of monitoring how things were progressing following on from MPF 3. And we tried to build kind of shared ownership of that with different lead partners for the existing national developments, etc. But planning is quite hard to monitor because a lot of the change that planning brings about is long term. And that's important to bear in mind. But we will look at how we monitor implementation as things progress and look at how that collaboration is working. And the monitoring is a requirement for some of the impact assessments as well. I think Andy Kinnaird wanted to come in further.
Yes, thanks. I'll just maybe say a bit about sort of the review and amendment. So the NPF can be amended in the same way as local development plans, as I mentioned earlier. So it can be amended without a full review and replacement if it's appropriate to do that. We'd want to consider the case for making any amendments alongside the confidence that comes from maintaining an established policy framework. But so the new provisions added by the 2019 Planning Act require that the NPF must be reviewed at least once every 10 years. But the Act also allows for Scottish ministers to amend the NPF at any time, and it enables us to make regulations that will set the procedures for future amendments. It also requires, though, that we must set out in regulations the circumstances in which an amendment would mean such a significant change that a full review would therefore become necessary. But we haven't progressed those regulations yet, but we intend to do that once NPF 4 has been adopted. We expect to sort of bring forward our proposals for review and amendment of the NPF later this year.
Yeah, thanks, Camina.
Thank you, Mark. We're going to now shift our, we've kind of already touched a little bit on housing, and we're going to just kind of shift it a bit more and really focus there. So I'm going to bring in Elena Whittam with some questions.
Thank you very much, convener. And one of the stated aims in the draft National Planning Framework 4 is that it wants to support the delivery of high quality, sustainable homes that meet the needs of people throughout their life. And I just want to touch on what Fiona's already discussed, which is the minimum all tenure housing land requirements. And can I ask, how do these figures actually differ from the arrangements that we've already got in place at the moment? Thank you.
Okay, so we've gone through a different process with this at the moment. There's requirements set out in the Scottish Planning Policy, and each local development plan, often working within the context of a strategic development plan, looks at what the housing land requirements are. We took a different approach in the National Planning Framework, where we took forward collaboration to think about how we could come up with some clearer figures in the National Planning Framework. And that's designed to be a bit broader and more flexible than previous approaches to calculating housing numbers. So it's expressed as a minimum all tenure housing land requirement, and the focus is on, rather than how many homes we expect to see actually built, it's more focused on how much land does each local development plan need to allocate And the reason for that is to really try and focus on land and its role within the overall development strategy. To do that, we took a different approach. So we did some work working across government with housing colleagues and with the Centre for Housing Market Analysis to set out some initial figures, which were sort of defined using the housing needs and demands assessment at a national level. But then we did a collaborative work with each local authority. We sent them the numbers and they had an opportunity to consider the numbers and to come back to us with their thoughts on how they wanted the figure to change. And we've set all of this out in a full explanatory report, and we've also set out our assessments of each of the local authority areas in detail. So the purpose of all of that is to try to provide that clearer steer to make it flexible, so a local authority can change that if they come forward with their local development plan. They can work with the minimum all-tenure housing land requirement, and if evidence indicates that needs to change, they can increase that if they choose to do so. So that's the overall kind of process that we've undertaken. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, it does help, Fiona. I have a wee further question on it. There's been some local authorities, you know, I'm specifically thinking of the two local authorities that my constituency covers in terms of rurality, where they've come back and, you know, they've perhaps said, you know, that the Honda analysis and figures are based on, you know, population at the moment. But what we're seeing is the pandemic's actually given rise to people seeking to move back into places like Ayrshire, where we saw a depopulation happen previously. Do you think the flexibility allows for that type of change and reflects the numbers of houses that are perhaps required that we didn't perhaps think were in the past?
Yes, I mean, we've already introduced a flexibility allowance to the figures. So we took the output of the HNDA and added quite significant level of flexibility, again reflecting the fact this is a long-term plan, a 10-year period that we're planning for. So we added 25% flexibility for urban areas and actually 30% for rural areas. And that was in the initial figures. And then authorities could look at those figures and provide adjusted estimates on top of that. But I think it's also one of the benefits of having a minimum requirement. So you can go much further than that, but it's you know, it's the amount of land that is set out as being a minimum that you would be planning for. Having said that, in the consultation that we're running on development planning and the guidance associated with the new regulations on local development planning, we're also changing the way we want to see authorities allocate land for development. And we're keen to establish a pipeline of allocated land for housing that will identify short, medium and much longer term development. And the policy in the MPF is designed to allow for some flex between that. So if you have an area where there is land allocated for housing development and that land is being used up and you're starting to see there's more demand, or you want to stimulate the demand in areas where the market is, perhaps has less interest, but you have placemaking objectives to attract development, then you can bring forward land from the longer term part of the plan that is thinking much longer term. But the aim of all of that is to try to have strong but flexible local development plans that can work with the level of take up of land and that are sufficiently flexible.
Thanks for that. And finally, for me, and sticking with that flexibility issue, Planning Democracy in their submission to the committee are asserting that there doesn't seem to be any rationale behind the flexibility, and the figures are sometimes amounting to approximately 77% over and above housing needs demand assessment figures. And they've got concerns that this is actually going to give rise to speculative housing building across whole of Scotland. How would you respond to that?
I think it comes down to flexibility. So if you have a long-term plan and it's flexible and you're on the front foot where you're thinking about what land will be required, not just immediately, but in the longer term, then you can take a planned approach to that, and you can be proactive in your local development plan to look at how you want to development to be distributed across your area and how it can fit with the infrastructure first approach as well. So although the figures are obviously set out as a minimum, you can work with all of that to think about how that development can be distributed to best improve that area over the longer term. So I would say the figures are not, they are evidence-based. We've been clear about what the evidence is when we set out, use the HNDA tool. We've added the flexibility allowance given the 10-year period that this is relating to, and we've taken into account what local authorities have come back to us when we've shared the figures with them and asked for responses. So I'd say overall there's a a positive approach to enabling good quality development, and to do that you need to plan upfront where that development should take place.
Thank you very much. Convener, back to yourself.
Thank you, Eleanor. I just wanted to continue on that theme a little bit, actually, because some of the current concerns I've heard are, the situation where the way in which housing happens in communities is that developers own land, and from what I understand, what the local the planning department does is puts out a call for that land supply, the generosity piece that we've spoken about. And what people have been raising to me is that up until recently we hadn't realized how important it is to actually protect our peatland, and kind of going forward, potentially how important, as we want to kind of shorten our supply chains and grow more food locally, our farmland is going to be, and that is in limited supply. So I just wonder what we do about situations where developers may have land that is actually in the long run with a kind of like shift and our just transition, and bringing things more locally. If they bring forward land that is better for farming or better to be protected than building on, I just wonder how we handle that kind of situation.
I think that comes back to looking at how the policies work in the rounds within the National Planning Framework. So we've set out a whole range of different policies. Some of those policies relate to specific types of development proposals that we would expect to see. Some of them relate to areas where we would want to encourage certain types of development, and others are about locations or features that are sensitive and that we want to see protected and where possible enhanced. So looking at those in the round, it's about balancing all of that up and coming back to the balance that Andy Kinnaird raised earlier. But I would still come back to a plan-led approach that has a clear vision for an area and is very place-based and recognises the particular features of an area is a really is what we want to see as being the effective way of guiding development in the future. The MPF, when it's introduced, will apply to, it doesn't apply retrospectively. It's about evolving and transitioning into sustainable patterns of development in the future.
Thank you, Fiona. I'm now going to move to a few questions from Paul McLennan, and then Willie Coffey is going to come in on a supplementary. But we might go over a little bit of our time, but I think we're okay.
Thanks, convener. And should I mention earlier on, just referring everyone to my register of interest, I'm a serving councillor in East Lothian Council at the moment. Fiona, it's really just to yourself, and it's really just expanding on the minimum multi-tenure housing land requirement. It's really a couple of questions. One is obviously around about the, obviously that covers a 10-year time frame, and it's really, and I think you've touched on this already. How will that the changes in housing be accounted for during that 10 years? And you already touched obviously about the Hondas, the housing needs as well within local authorities, and how I suppose the approach that's been taken will link in with local housing strategies. 10 years is a long time, as we know, in planning requirements, and it comes back, I think, to the issue you talked about flexibility. I don't know if there's anything else you want to add on that. I'm probably coming back to my time as a councillor as well. In the last 10 years, things have changed dramatically in my own local authority. So it's really just touch up on that point, if you don't mind.
Yes, I think the overall approach that we've taken to the policies on housing are designed to remember that it's not just about planning. It must be about planning joining up effectively with housing, and the local housing strategy has a really important role to play. The role of sort of shared tools like the HNDA again is really important. So we've designed all of that to be flexible. We're conscious, for example, that a local housing strategy runs to a shorter time frame. I think it's 4 years. If a local housing strategy came forward and was resulting in significant changes, or suggested that you might need to look again at your local development plan, the beauty of some of the new provisions of the Planning Act are that you would be able to, rather than having to go back to the beginning and review your whole plan, you will be able to update it in part, and we'll bring forward regulations on that. So there's flexibility in there to allow for that read across with housing policy, and ultimately, you know, housing and planning need to work together to deliver that. And I think that's quite clear messaging that comes from Housing 2040, actually. But again, it's going back to having a minimum, but also a plan-led approach with a flexible pipeline of housing allocations would mean that plans can flex, but have that strong core spatial strategy and vision.
Okay, just a supplementary, if you don't mind. What one, and again, it comes back to the deliverability side of things. And do we look at and how we monitor deliverability over a period of time? Is it done every? I know that's difficult because every local authority is in a different position. But in terms of deliverability, is there a mechanism in place to measure that? You know, if a local authority has only delivered 20% of its allocation within that 10 years and we're 7 or 8 years in, obviously that's going to create a problem. Is there a mechanism in place that you have in terms of that to look at that over all local authorities, obviously, and overall within Scotland?
Yes, there is a lot of debate on all of that within the planning system at the moment. What we've sought to do in the guidance on local development planning is to look at this. We think the housing land audits could play a really important part of that process. Local authorities prepare them at the moment, but they're done differently in different areas. So that's an area we would like to look at, so that housing is informed by information that everyone's signed up to and everyone's clear, rather than having lots of different interpretations of the numbers and how things are progressing. So an important area to look at for local development plans, and I think we've covered some of that, of what we're expecting in the guidance on local development planning.
Okay, Fiona, thank you. Thanks, convener.
Thanks, Paul. And now I'd like to bring in Willie Coffey on the theme of urban transformation.
Hi, thanks very much, convener, for allowing me to come back in. Just as colleagues were talking there, I was having a look at the central urban transformation section of the document and in relation to what I was asking about earlier. But it seems to me that the policy intention here, it's really talking about major disused sites and areas blighted by dereliction in the past, like open cast and stuff like that. But what I'm talking about is our high streets and the blight of abandoned, empty, filthy shops that with trees and bushes growing out them and bits of abandoned land within the urban envelope. Do you think I'm barking up the wrong tree here, Fiona? Are these powers best left to other areas of existing planning and enforcement? Or do you think we can reach out and tackle these kinds of issues within the framework's proposals itself?
I think that is very much what we're trying to achieve. So we are recognising in the policies and the town centre reviews informed us around, you know, how places are changing, and how, although planning really has to focus on new development proposals. So it's, you know, it's responding to applications that come for development. It's doing that within a context of thinking ahead within the local development plan of what the future vision is for a place. So we have in the central urban transformation zone, we're talking quite a lot about reinventing and future-proofing city centres, and we're talking about different uses as well that could be supported, and that will require some imagination different thinking to think about how those areas can be developed in the future. There's a new policy on town centre living backing that up as well, and getting the balance right between the range of uses will be really important for these areas. I hope that goes some way towards answering your question.
It does a wee bit, but I'm sure the other members are seeing this in any town centre, high street in Scotland, that there's loads and loads of empty shops that are basically, in my opinion, just being left to rot. And try as I might, I've tried this on a number of occasions, get the owners or the agents to do something about it, even to clean them. Even a simple request to clean up a building and make it look a bit more appealing often falls on deaf ears, because it all comes down to cost eventually. So the noble aims within the document that we have to be future-proof and reinvent our city centres, how do we bridge that gap, do you think, when some owners or agents will simply even refuse to clean up a building and a shop and get rid of the graffiti that's stuck to a window? How on earth do we achieve that? And is this the right place for us to try to attempt to do that?
I think some of that may go beyond planning. I don't know if Andy Kinnaird wants to come in to mention anything around enforcement powers.
Thanks. Andy?
Yeah. Hi. Okay. Hi. Happy to do that. And so you mentioned yourself earlier, even just the access to amenity notices as one of the range of enforcement powers that are available to authorities, just to require that cleanup to happen to some extent. So that's certainly one of the areas. Also, kind of running sort of parallel to the policy, if someone going through a wide transformation of the planning system as a whole.
Excuse me, Andy. Sorry.
Yes, hello.
Your mic is a little bit close to your mouth, and so there's a lot of kind of like, yeah.
Beg
Let's
pardon.
See if that
right,
works.
Try that again.
Thanks.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, alongside the policy review, and this is one part of a much wider transformation in the whole of the planning system and how it operates, and so. As part of that, we've also got a commitment to look again just at land assembly, so supporting the push to have more investment coming into town centres. We have proposals also to look at how we review and update compulsory purchase powers, and also to take a look at compulsory sale order powers in the future. And we have a commitment to look at that with a view to legislation coming forward later in this session of Parliament. So the policy driver in NPF4 is certainly looking to get more activity happening within town centres, but so much of what's happening across the whole sort of planning reform agenda is interlinked, and some will require new legislation or just that change of mindset.
Just very lastly, Ariane, on that amenity notice issue, Andy, if a local authority serves an amenity notice on an owner or an agent of a shop or a building, and it's not carried through, not actioned or challenged or whatever, does the burden then fall on the local authority to complete the action? Because I've heard that may be the case, and perhaps that's why so few amenity notices are ever served. Is that the case?
So yeah, authorities do have direct action powers that they can take, and then bill the owner for the work. I know that there's sort of been difficulty in recouping the costs in the past. In the new Planning Act, we had sort of looked at new powers that would allow authorities to place charging orders onto a property to make sure they at least get that back at some point. But okay. The authorities do have the powers to take it on.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. Thanks, Camille.
Thanks, Willie. I just wanted to Last little question here, just picking up a little bit on the question that Mark Griffin had earlier around the kind of process of monitoring and reviewing the MPF. What trigger would be in place? What could trigger a review before the 10 years? Maybe we'll go with Fiona.
I think it's impossible to set out that. I think it's a case of you will know it when you see it. I mean, I think it would be where the MPF needs to change because something significant has happened or there's a very significant shift in policy. We have designed it to be flexible in that way and struck a balance between providing certainty and predictability with that flexibility. So we'd hope it can stand the test of time, but again, we'd be really looking at how the circumstances have changed and whether that means that the planning response needs to change significantly.
Thanks for that, because I do think it is important that we're here kind of creating a document somewhat, you know, yes, evidence-based, but somewhat abstractly with a lot of changing context with climate and nature emergency. So it's good to hear that, you know, there is this potential for flexibility and that, yes, reviewing is considered an important part of it. So I think that's the end of our questions. Thank you very much for joining us. I think it's been very helpful to hear the kind of the how, the thinking behind how this complex document came into being and to hear from the beginning what you laid out about how so many different stakeholders were engaged in the process. So it's been very useful for our evidence sessions. So thanks for being with us this morning.
Thank you.
As agreed, as part of our approach to the MPF4, we'll now consider the evidence we have just heard in private, and I now close the public part of the meeting, and we will move into private.